7. Ezekiel is our lectionary passage for this season, and certainly I started a little bit of this at the East Bayland Caravan on Wednesday, and it's going to be our kind of theme for the next several weeks, even leading through Easter. We're going to talk a little bit about this idea called the sunken place or the sunken church syndrome. And some of you, amen, may think what you know what I'm going to say, amen, because you've probably seen this movie called Get Out. And it is certainly inspired. Some of it is inspired by this, but I do think there's deep theological work happening not only in that film, but in this season. So these next few weeks, we're going to be exploring how do we hear the voice of God, particularly when we are dealing with living in a sunken place, or particularly as the church, what are we doing since we are struggling with what I call the sunken church syndrome. So Ezekiel chapter 37 is where we're going to spend our time on this morning. We're going to start at the 11th verse. I don't know how many of you have ever read the book of Ezekiel before. Anybody? Yes, a few of y'all. Ezekiel is one of these prophets who, in many respects, is considered to be a prophet, apocalyptic prophet, a prophet who had very powerful visions about not only what is, but also what is to come. Ezekiel was one of these individuals whose visions and whose prophetic declarations were always considered a warning, but also an invitation, a warning and an invitation for those who would want to follow the ways of God. The prophets were always there to remind the children of Israel of their covenant responsibility. That when you make a promise to God, how many of you know sometimes the promise that you make to God, the longer it takes for God to fulfill God's promise, sometimes we can get a little nervous. Dare I say doubtful. If we keep it real, dare I say forgetful. And we can forget about not only the promise that God made to us, but also the promise we made to God. And so this is going to give us, I think, a wonderful opportunity to think and to consider, particularly even on this Sunday where we will celebrate the Eucharist celebration, the many ways that I believe we are being called not only out of a sunken place, but maybe even think a little bit about what has caused us to end up in some places where we are struggling to hear the voice of God. Ezekiel chapter 37, verse number 11. It's on the screen, I believe. So certainly you can follow along in your Bibles or read with us on the screen. The scripture says, "Then God said to me, 'Mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel.'" And maybe I'll give you a little bit of context. The prophet is led up into a wilderness, a whole wilderness where there are nothing but dry bones or skeletons as far as the eye can see. And in many respects, it's a big graveyard. It's a grave site. And if you know anything about the graveyards and grave sites, particularly in this time, they usually were considered hell. That is what the original language, Gehenna, for hell was, the place where bodies were kept after they died. It was usually a pit that was kept outside of the city, and they threw all the bodies into this pit, and they burned the bodies, and this is where they kept. It was their graveyard. It was their place of burial, and for many folks, it was even considered a place where the afterlife and after the spirits and all these different kind of their own understanding of what happened to folks after they transition. In the Jewish context, this is perhaps one of these valleys, one of these large pits where Valley of Dry Bones. Ezekiel was having a vision, and God took him to the Valley of Dry Bones, and God gave him all these various different kinds of instructions to prophesy and to speak and to call the wind, and the bones started to rattle, and the bones stood up. Can you imagine? You standing in a valley, and all of a sudden, you see nothing but a bunch of skeletons, amen, kind of staring at you, amen. I don't know, it may leave quite an impression, praise God. May cause you to think a little bit about your own life Amen. But anyhow, we're picking up verse number 11. Then God said to me, Ezekiel, mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore, prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, and I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live. And I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Let us say thanks be to God. Again, so we're going to talk about, amen, what put you in the sunken place. Amen. Bow your heads with me. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you will bless the word of God that has been read for us, the people of God. We ask you to hide this word in our hearts so we will not sin against you. And please send your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. Let it rest upon me and even the hearers of this word. And we'll say thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the people of God say amen. Amen. How many of y'all seen the movie Get Out? A few of y'all. All right. How many have not seen the movie Get Out? All right. So I'll probably need to, amen. How many of y'all planning to see the movie Get Out? One after church, one or two. All right. So I won't ruin it too terribly for you. But this movie is a very powerful kind of movie that really speaks to the dilemmas of all kinds of systems and structures and sensibilities. It is a movie about a young man, a young black guy who dates this white young sister, and she is inviting him to come to her house, kind of like guess who's coming to dinner type thing, if you're familiar with that old school movie. And he proceeds to take the trip to their house, and all along the way, there are some certain signs that point to something is getting ready to happen that's not probably in anybody's best interest. But certainly as the movie goes along, you begin to see all kinds of themes that I think are worthy of our reflection. Particularly, the movie speaks very powerfully about the way in which trauma, particularly unresolved trauma, can become a place in which you and I can not only be vulnerable, but also find ourselves locked into a pattern. Dare I say, a way of existence and living that is characterized by paralysis. It also gives us some powerful warnings about who we fall in love with and who we give our hearts to. Now, of course, the movie, speaking, you know, is laying bare a lot of the issues around interracial kind of relationships and whatnot. And it's fascinating because the writer of the film, he himself is in an interracial relationship. So he's talking about, he said this for the sake of his wife, right? Because he's like, I'm not talking about my current wife's family. That was a good cleanup for him, right? Amen. But I think, you know, more than the relationships around being in an interracial space, of course, there's a whole bunch of racial over and undertones there. And I also think there's a huge commentary about the ways in which the powers of our world, the dominant powers, the powers that seek to make humanity or at least human value normative through the racial hierarchy that we talk about kind of often around here related to whiteness and issues of the prioritization of European values and ideals and how that creates an environment, particularly right now in the age of Trump, where issues of white nationalism and all these things are starting to rear their ugly head, that all of us, regardless of your racial background or your ethnic background, we have to resist and, dare I say, defeat racial hierarchy. This idea that some folks' lives and culture and sensibilities and ways of living are more valuable than anybody else's. Hello, somebody. This idea that you and I have not been valued in our full selves, and when we don't resist this, then we demean and diminish the imago Dei, or the image of God that has been placed in every single person. Regardless of your gender, regardless of your racial background, regardless of your country of origin, regardless of these categories that rarely give us a full account of who we are, these kinds of forces and powers must be resisted and, dare I say, defeated by God's church. And so as I, you know, watched the film and thought about the film and really thought about the many ways in which our church, Universal, the body of Christ, has found ourselves, I believe, hijacked, hypnotized, and rendered paralyzed by the forces that would seek to steal our mind, our body, our purpose, and our function, and appropriate it to a mission of this world that, how many of you know, is totally anti-Christ. That in many respects, there is so much at stake when you and I lose our sense of purpose, our sense of who we are and who we've been called to be. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 says it so powerfully, that you are a chosen generation. We are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own peculiar people. Think about all that. You're a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. You are a peculiar people. Tell your neighbor, I knew there was something strange about you. Amen. There's some strange. I mean, can you imagine what it would mean if we, the church, actually lived our lives in such a way that the world thought we were strange? We're strange because we love and we embrace and we forgive and we're nonviolent and we're not pursuing the exploitative elements of this world, but we are trying to figure out how do we make our lives reflect the chosenness, the royalty, the holiness, and even the peculiarity that we are. I want to submit to you that when we forget about who we are easily overtaken then by the seduction of a fallen world. And this seduction is often manifests itself through sin. And it is so important as we get closer to Resurrection Sunday, as we are on this journey towards Lent, that we don't forget that the reason why Jesus had to die is because you and I were in danger of our sin permanently disqualifying us from relationship with God. It is not that Jesus came because Jesus had nothing else better to do. Well, not because Jesus came because Jesus just, you know, felt like being tortured and felt like reducing himself into the limitations of human existence. I mean, think about this. Theologically, we know that Jesus in the Godhead, in the Trinity, equal with God. The scriptures in Philippians chapter 2 says that Jesus, he did not regard equality with God as something to hold on to. Meaning that Jesus realized that if salvation was going to be possible for you and I, Jesus had to be willing to voluntarily evacuate himself of his own privilege. Now, that is quite a price to pay, which should give you and I a sense of how diabolical our sinful lives are. Because some of us feel like, well, you know, sinny sin sin, you know, over here between Norman and West, we call it a little 20-twin-twin, and this little sinny sin sin, and we laugh and we make jokes about it. Amen. But how many know Jesus coming to earth was no joke? Jesus didn't come to earth because of your little sinny sin sin. Jesus came to earth because your sin, my sin, our sin was literally unraveling. Who God intend did for us to be. And when you and I lose sight of why Jesus came, then we will kind of just feel like Jesus is just kind of nice to have. Well, Jesus is nice to have, like this trophy I have on my mantle for winning a football tournament, and then this diploma I have on my wall for getting a PhD from UC Berkeley, and then this promotion I got on my job for being the greatest employee in the history of the company and humanity, and now I got a place for Jesus right next to all that. How many of y'all know Jesus is a little bit higher on the totem pole? And when you and I lose track of the ways in which sin, and when we talk about sin, I'm not just talking about your list of do's and don'ts, you know, that, you know, because most of us, when we create a sin list, even when we go to the scriptures, we usually pick the sins that we don't struggle with. And then we're like, oh, yeah, God is worried about this sin. And you preach on it hard. You pray on it hard. Then when it comes to your sin, it's a very like, oh, have mercy on me. Lord knows my heart. Me and God, we got an agreement. We got a treaty, me and God. Show me grace, but show everybody else judgment. Hello, somebody. But it's important to appreciate. I love Simon Chan. He's an Asian theologian. He talks about sin like this. The sin within us, that's all of the struggles in our flesh. I think 1 John chapter 2 calls it the pride of life, the pride of the eyes, the lust of your flesh, the sin within us. How many know we all got some sin that is within us that we're going to have to wrestle with, amen? Thank God for those 10 honest folk, amen? I'll pray for the rest of y'all, amen? Then we got the sin around us, and that sin is all the social evil. All the sin that is around us that we see, the injustice, the genocide, the wars, racism, transphobia, hatred, sin around us. And then we got the sin beyond us. And that's the devil and all the devil's business. Amen. And, you know, I think if there's any kind of focus you and I should have, it shouldn't be on the devil. Amen, because the devil's already a defeated foe. You ought to give your neighbor a high five and tell him God already took care of that devil. He's already under my feet. Oh, but then that still leaves some sin that you and I got to pay attention to. And it is that sin, when left unaddressed, that can cause you and I to end up in a sunken place. I mean, if you take the sunken place serious, in the movie, this young man was not prepared to deal with his trauma. He was not prepared to deal with his struggles and his issues, and it left him open to someone else who was more skilled to manipulate the weaknesses and vulnerabilities of his life. And it caused him to end up in a free fall, where he was hollering, but nothing was coming out of his mouth. Where he's reaching and he can't grab onto anything. Anybody ever felt like that before in your life? Lord, I'm trying to speak to you, but I ain't got nothing to say. I'm reaching up for you, but I seem to not be able to grab you. And in that moment and in that season, I hear God saying, there's some things that I need you to address first. Because if we're going on this journey towards resurrection, how many know next week it's going to kick off Holy Week, where we're going to have to first go by the cross. And as much as you and I want to skip resurrection or skip the cross and get to resurrection, sometimes you need a cross to help tease out some of those things within and around you that help push you into a sunken place. I love this theologian, Athanasius. He's one of the earliest theologians. He's from North Africa. He actually helped to put together the first New Testament. And I think 387 AD, Athanasius, he has this quote, and he says, "You cannot put straight in others what is warped in yourself." He says, "You cannot put straight in others what is warped in yourself." And how many of you know some of this journey towards Calvary and resurrection isn't just about what's happening outside of us? But God's trying to get some work done inside of some of us as well. Ooh, it's quiet in here today. I knew it'd be a little quiet, amen. Because some of us are in the sunken place. Some of us are in a place where we are clearly falling and we can't get up. Our voices and our situations and our circumstance are causing you and I to be far from where our purpose has called us to be. And I want to suggest that one of the greatest challenges of the Church of Jesus Christ in this moment is to reclaim our rightful place, our moral and spiritual authority, which allows us through our worship and our service and our ministry and our lived lives an opportunity to reflect that God is able to bring us out of these sunken places, these graves that the prophet talks about. I mean, take it seriously, Ezekiel chapter 37, that for many of us, we are in a deep pit where we have nothing but deadly, death-filled, dry bones environments. I mean, that's the first thing that I think the scriptures lift up that are worthy of our consideration, that you and I may find ourselves in a sunken place as a church, as a people, because we are filled and surrounded by dried bones. Somebody holler, dry bones. Verse number 11, the people through their own testimony in the text stand up and they say that our bones are dried. And I want to submit to you that there's a whole lot of things that make your life get sucked out of you to the point where you've dried up. Whole lot of things. I love the physicality of this particular passage and how it is very much concrete material, things that speak to the ways in which death is visiting us as a people, as a community, as a nation, in our families, in our own selves. Think about all the many ways that death continues to knock at our door, invade our social and familial networks. The scripture says that our bones are dried up. Don't you know that no matter what is your cause of death on a death certificate, the true cause of death, when it's all peeled back, is stress. When stress penetrates your physical body, whether it is through a weapon, too much stress, and the weapon rips through your body and the stress causes your organs to collapse. It could be stress unseen. Microaggressions of racism and all the other isms that you and I are aware of. That's why it's so important for you and I as people of God to appreciate there are many different ways the enemy will try to attack us. I love Kimberly Crenshaw Williams in her clinical scholarly way. She talks about it as intersectionality. That you and I show up in the world in a lot of different ways. And you can be all focused on one thing and another thing be wide open. And how many of you know when you don't have your whole life wrapped up in God, you can leave one part of yourself wide open and the enemy will come and attack that with a stress-filled attack. All around us, we see the physical manifestations stress, of death, and our bones are drying up. That thing that is supposed to be a source of life for you is no longer able to provide you with the nutrients and the strength you need. When your bones get brittle, your bones easily break. And when your bones break, you then need to depend on something else to support you. And if too many of your bones break, you become paralyzed. How many of you know that we got a lot of paralysis happening in our world right now? A lot of broken bones because of our inability to deal with the stress, dare I say the sin, those factors, those things that are attacking us from all different kind of angles. I wasn't able to be here last week. I thank God Pastor Nisha lifted up the missing girls that were breaking through to the public conversation. How many know there's a strange narrative and a strange reality that folk can be missing right in our own community? And we wouldn't know anything about it unless somebody else reported it to us. How is it then that missing girls can be right under our noses and we know nothing about it? Missing family members going to jail, prison, being deported, and you and I wouldn't know that much about it. I mean, I know that we're all turned up right now, as we should be, around the ways in which this administration is putting stress and pressure on many of our families and deporting them. How many of you know the last administration, you know, the one that we all is very celebratory of, the one I work with, was deporting millions of folk too? Now, what is it about we as a people that we can see all this death around us and we not be able or willing to respond? Could it be that the deaths, whether by guns, whether by incarceration, whether by kidnapping or trafficking, all of this death is contributing to a sunken place in our lives? Because many of us who are aware can easily find ourselves filled with despair because it seems like God has forgotten about some of us. I know you never say it in church and raise your hand and admit it, because we don't do that kind of thing in church, you know, tell the truth. But could it be that for some of us, life is being stolen from us because we are surrounded by environments of death and we can't see God at work? Called cognitive dissonance. Lord, help me today. When you know something's supposed to be a certain way, but it's not. And you know what God said, but then you see what's happening. But this is why the word of God must be yours, and you must build your life. The scripture says, God's word have I hid in my heart. Why? So whenever I start to find myself in a situation that is totally opposite of what I know to be true, I can start rehearsing in my mind. This is what God said. This is what God did. And this is what God will do. Give your neighbor a high five and tell him God has not forgot about you. So you and I finding ourselves in these places where our bones are dried up. Let me ask you some questions then that you must, I think, wrestle with if you're going to find yourself getting past the dry bones, the dry seasons. Who is stealing life from us? How many know some of the worst perpetrators of death aren't folks outside of us, outside of our communities, outside of our relationships, outside of our families, dare I say outside of ourselves? I remember hearing it. Someone said that the greatest enemy is in me. Ooh, yes, Lord. Somebody pat yourself and say, Lord, help me to get over me. Help me to get over me. Help me to get over me. Who is stealing life from us? And is your current environment defined by death? Defined by the skeletons? The perpetual pain that is in your life or your history? I want to submit that some of us end up in a sunken place because we are too overdetermined and defined by loss, by deficit, by death. And as we're on this road to Calvary and to resurrection, I hear God trying to say to some of us, you got to get honest and real about your environments. You got to get honest and real about who you're surrounding yourself with. Because you won't get to your destiny if you keep surrounding yourself with your history. Oh, somebody holler, dry bones, dry bones, dry bones. The second thing that the scripture lifts up in verse number 11, they stand up and say that our bones are dried up. And the second thing, our hope is lost. Somebody holler, lost hope. You and I end up in a sunken place and we can't hear the voice of God because we lose hope. And it is no more evidence to me the loss of hope in our communities than the growing numbers of folk who are becoming agnostic. People who are becoming atheists. When you lose your hope, how many of you know that you have a spiritual death that begins to set in? That the hope of God is the life source that keeps you coming back to God for more. God, I know that this situation is terrible, but my hope keeps having me show up. Faith keeps sustaining you. Hope keeps bringing you back. That's why your faith and your hope are intricately linked. If you can't have faith, then you probably won't have a lot of hope. And how many of you know we're living in an age where our faith in God is getting stretched? Hello, somebody. Amen. Folks trying to figure this thing out. Lord, I know what my grandmama and them said, and I know what my mama and them said, but it's the 21st century. Look at all these problems. Look at all these moments and these times where you let me down, God. Am I speaking real to y'all this morning? Look at all these prayers I prayed and those prayers went unanswered. Look at all these actions I took and nothing seemed to get better. So God, rather than continuing to pray, rather than continuing to act, I'm just going to go my own way. And I'm going to trust in my own strength. But the problem with your own strength is that your own strength is never enough. I know some of y'all in here, you got a whole lot of stuff. You got stuff for days. You got knowledge for days. You got money for days. You got friends for days. You got self-determination for days. But isn't there something that is a situation that will come in your life that your money and your stuff and your strength still can't get you to your destiny and your place of purpose? And this is where I hear God saying that if you can hold on to your hope and not throw in the towel, if you can remember where was the last time you felt hope, where was the last place where you felt filled with hope, who and what were the last people or practices that you were engaging in where hope was in abundance? Some of us need to go back to a hope-filled place. Some of us need to make sure if you're in a valley of dry bones, how do you find a mountain of hope? How do you find a place of hope? A place where you don't have to wonder where hope, if hope will meet you there. But as soon as you show up, you know hope is there in abundance. And if you have no hope, you will be reaching for that which cannot catch you. There ain't nothing like falling, trying to grab onto something that can't catch you. I don't know if you ever seen someone who, you know, was falling for a long time. I remember watching one of these videos. Poor sister, she had on her heels and she was graduating. She was trying to walk. I don't know if y'all seen it. And she was walking and she was just going and it's just literally, it took her like 30 seconds and she was reaching. She was reaching. She was reaching and boom, hit the floor. I mean, that's how some of us look when we don't have no hope. We going through our lives. The reason why is because you tasted hope before. You knew to reach for something, but you just can't grasp it. And because you know it's out there, you're reaching for it, but you're reaching in all the wrong places. But I hear God saying, don't you dare lose your hope. When in doubt, reach for God. When in trouble, reach for God. Reach for God's word. Reach for God's people. Reach for God's place. Don't cast away your confidence. Don't throw away your faith because it's taking too long. How many of you know help may be right around the corner? Hallelujah. I hear God speaking to somebody in here today. Your hope may feel like it's lost, but I hear God saying it is nearer to you than you ever imagined. You'll get out of this sunken place, I believe, if you recover your hope. So what then is the question? What part of your life is in need of hope? Your relationships may be hopeless. The state of our communities, if you look around, hope is waning. The more folk I talk to, some folk feel like that we just a cursed people. A cursed family. A cursed community. Nothing we can do will change these conditions. Do you know what kind of family I came from, Pastor Mike? It's not going to change. You know what part of town I grew up in? You see all this melanin in my skin? You know what gender I am? You know what struggle, what attractions I have? There are no hope. There is no hope for me. I'm here to tell you that hope is not predicated on you. Hope is about God. Hallelujah. Give your neighbor a high five and tell him, my hope in God. So what then are you willing to do this week to disrupt hopelessness? Hallelujah. I was talking to our couples and I was saying, sometimes your relationship can get in such a rut that you gotta do some activities continuously to help jumpstart the love and the affection and all these things that used to be there in abundance. How many know sometimes you can get in a rut in your walk with God, in your relationships, in your vocation, and you need to jumpstart yourself? What are you willing to do this week to jumpstart yourself so you can disrupt the hopelessness? What would like for you every day to wake up and get 5 or 6 scriptures about hope and memorize those and walk through your day confessing hope? What would it like for you every day to take 10, 15, 20 minutes and just say, I don't even know if God hears my voice, but I'm going to pray. Amen. What would it like for you to say, for the next 8 weeks, I'm going to make sure that I'm in a small group and I'm attending church and I'm giving as much time to God as I give to my homies and my boo and my job. Because obviously your homies, your boo, and your job can't disrupt your hopelessness, or you would not be hopeless. Are there some spiritual practices that you can engage in to help you withstand this season? And then finally, the last thing that I think contributes to us being in a sunken place is the scriptures say that they declared that they are completely cut off. My greatest fear, my greatest prayer is to not be cast away from the presence of God. Because I really believe I need the Lord. I mean, I know the things that go on in my mind. Sometimes I know my actions. Sometimes I know. How many of you ever got some actions? You'd be like, where did that come from? Wow, that's surprise, surprise, surprise. I thought all that was out of me. Any honest folk in here today, amen. All right, thank God, thank God. But I believe and I trust that God being connected to me, my life, my community, my dreams, my aspirations, and conversely, me being connected to God's dreams, God's vision, God's aspirations will keep me from being in a perpetual place of sunkenness. I love in the text where the scriptures, the prophet is prophesying, and he says that it is will be God who will act to open up these graves, open up these pits. Isn't it a blessing to know that if you can stay connected to God, God will bring you out of these pits of depression, hopelessness? You may be sick in your body and the doctors don't know what to do. We serve God who heals bodies. Some of us are like, but God ain't did it yet. That's the greatest word you ever spoke. Yet. Give your neighbor a high five and tell him yet, yet. I'm waiting on God. Just because it hasn't happened don't mean it won't. I'm going to keep trusting God. Can you imagine if you lived your life without the yet? Hallelujah. Can you imagine if everything that you wanted to happen, you did not have a sense of the yet? You didn't have a sense that tomorrow was going to be better than today. You didn't have a sense that your next phase of life is going to be a continued momentum of your past success. You didn't have a sense that the sin that defined you yesterday will not overdetermine your future because of grace and because of forgiveness and because of God's love. The yet is the hope that you must lean into until it happens. And then when it happens, you won't have to worry about the yet. You can now start to holler, hallelujah. You can start to holler, he did it for me. They used to say, Lord, if you do it for me, I'll praise you like I've never praised you before. I have a story and a testimony. Lord, when I feel like I'm completely cut off, Lord, build a bridge back to me. Even if I'm the one that burned the bridge, Lord, keep building a bridge back. Even if I'm the one that keeps turning away, Lord, do not leave me to my own devices. Do not leave me to my own failures, my own doubts, my own unbelief. Don't leave me in a sunken place. Don't cut me off. But God, while you are making your journey to Calvary, and you're holding and handling the sins of the world, take my sins too. Take my burdens too. Take my my struggles too. Whether it's the sin within me, God take it. Whether it's the sin around me, God deal with it. Whether it's the sin beyond me, keep knocking the devil out of my life. Whatever you must do, God, keep showing me that I don't have to stay in this place. But Sunday morning, resurrection, Easter. God, I can see that resurrection and Easter and Sunday is not an annual celebration, but it's a daily reality. Every morning I wake up, bring me out. Lift me up. Help me stand so I can boldly declare that in the land of the living, I am a witness to the saving power of God. Come stand with us, everyone. Let's take a few moments.